Thank you, worship team. They always do such a good job in lifting up the name of Jesus. I'm grateful for them. If you have your Bibles, I'd love it if you could turn to Matthew 14. Matthew 14 with me. As we get into this passage, as you're turning there, you're going to look at the header of this passage, and some of you may be like, I've heard this story a million times. Thank you for preaching on this story a million and one. All right. It's something I always want to preface as we get into the Word, even if it's something you've heard a million times. I don't know the Christian who loves Jesus that's read the Bible once and then thrown the Bible away. You continue to read it, right? And you learn something from what you've already read. So I want to encourage you as we get into this story this morning that you would open your hearts and your ears to what Jesus would have for us this morning. And so with that being said, I want to kind of set this up. I don't always get the opportunity to preach the week before, so contextually, sometimes we can just jump into a spot. I want to make sure, one, you know why I'm preaching this specifically, and the other one is context. And so the reason why I jumped to this is something that's been just on my heart. And I've been wrestling with this for a while. As I look on Facebook, as I look and listen to even Christians and the world, and here's something that I've noticed. Knowledge, or how much we know, gets thrown around a lot. Now, I'm all about knowledge. I think knowledge is paramount, right? We read the book of Proverbs, and we can see to know is a good thing. Knowledge is in a lot of ways power. But in for us, the more we know about the Word, the deeper we fall in love with Jesus. But what I want to address today is this idea of knowledge just staying knowledge. I want us to think about this because I see the tug of war happening in our world today. And social issues, how you should run church, how things should go. And what I'm seeing is you have this worldly wisdom where they're on this side of the rope tugging this way. You see biblical wisdom tugging this way, and no one's really doing anything. That little red marker staying right in the middle. And what tends to happen, Christians, is we start fighting this battle the way the world says we should fight it. You should know more. You should have more degrees. You should, when you come to the table, you ought to have all of this stuff. I don't know if you know this, but in the book of Acts, when Peter is standing before a group of leaders, what does it say about them? They knew they had been with Jesus, but they were shocked. They were unlearned men. Think about that. The lens in what we're going to learn this through is I want us to take, if you have opportunity at some point, to also put a finger or your bulletin or whatever at James 1. The reason why is we're going to be flipping back and forth. James 1:22, one of my favorite verses in the Bible. Some of us know it. If you don't know it, I would implore you to memorize this. It says this: be doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving yourself. Be doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving yourself. And we're going to be flipping back and forth between Matthew 14 and James 1. And so with that, I would love to read this passage with you. In Matthew 14, 22. And keep that finger there or something there. If you don't have a Bible, you can use the Pew Bible. It's on page 820. It says this: immediately he made the disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But the boat by this time was a long way from the land, beaten by the waves, for the wind was against them. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, "It is a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." And Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took hold of him, saying to him, "O you of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." Let's pray. God, I ask this morning as we get into your word that you would be the voice that's loudest. And I pray that it would be your words that change the hearts of men, not mine, not my opinions, nothing of me. It would be all you. And we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So you see the message here, get out of the boat. This is a phrase that I had heard from a pastor friend of mine that was very, very influential in my life. His name was Don Jackson, is Don Jackson, that was. He didn't change his name. But he was all about this mindset of getting out of the boat. And there's multiple reasons why, but I'm going to share a story with you that's a tough story to share. And one of the reasons is because it's extremely relevant in my life right now. Recently, in the past year, we've had someone in our subdivision that this individual will drive by our house and yell things out the window, like, God's not real, God's dead, prayer doesn't work. And we could look at that and be like, well, what a huge form of persecution, Jason, just walk into your house, right? The problem is that he doesn't say it to me. He says it when my wife is out there. So if I'm out there, they'll drive by and I don't hear anything. It bothers me for a couple reasons. The first reason is he's mocking my God. That should bother you when God is mocked, because he is real. He's not just real to me. He's real. And so when this happens, at one point my window was open of the house and this person drives by and yells something. I thought it was my wife yelling something up, like into the window at me, which isn't uncommon. So I'm like, walk over to the window. I go, "Did you say something?" She said, "No." They drove by again and yelled something. The other thing that is hard for me is that it's yelled at my wife, and I protect my wife. It bothers me. We'll jump ahead to this winter. The big snowstorm that we had, the 10 to 15 inches that came through. So I love, some of you guys are going to be like, this is why I don't like you. I love snow. Okay, so a lot of you are like, then you need to go north, all right? I do. I love being out in it. I grew up in the country, so when it snowed, I got to be outside and hike in it. Well, in town, I get to, when it snows, I'm like, hey, it's a good form of workout for me. I get my snow shovel, and I start shoveling my driveway. And I love being out there. I love doing that because you get that immediate satisfaction. You get to see, like, actual progress happening, and it's a beautiful thing. Well, Wednesday, it snows a lot, and I shovel my driveway twice. I try to get ahead of it, and I like being out there anyway. Thursday, I do the same thing. So Friday rolls around, and I'm able to get out and go to work. And so I get up that morning, and I do what most of us do in the morning, get a cup of coffee and open Facebook, because I'm curious what has happened in the past 8 hours that I was asleep. So I open Facebook, right, and we start scrolling through the things, and I had a notification, a couple of them. And so I open the notifications, and it this individual had gotten on to Grace Bible Church's page and started reacting to some of the sermons with the laughter reaction. And I was like, man, Lord, you're not letting me get away from this thing. And I didn't know what to do about it. So, one, I want to say to you, don't go on Grace Bible and just search for this person. I want to protect this person. I love this person. And this is recorded, so that's why it's a hard thing for me to talk about, because I don't know if he's going to ever listen to it. And if he does, I don't want him to feel ashamed. I want him to know that I love him. So I'm sitting there and I see this. I don't know what to do with it. I'm like, and I look at my wife and I was like, I'm going to have to talk to him. But I don't know how that conversation is going to go, because I've waved to him as he drove by and he like eyes straight ahead. So how do I handle this? Well, I get in the car and I'm headed to work. I get all the way to work here at the church. I go to the door and I realize that I forgot my church keys. Well, the thing was, is on the way to work, I said a prayer. The Bible says to pray for those who persecute you. So I prayed for him. I can't do anything right now, but Jesus can, and so I pray for this individual. And this was my prayer. It's about a 2-minute drive from my house, so I shotgun prayer it, right? And I say, Lord, change their heart. Only you can. And if I am the vessel or the avenue that that's the case, Lord, give me an opportunity to serve him. I will tell you, if you pray that prayer, God will answer it. As I showed up at work and I forgot my church keys, so I had to go back home, and I go up and I run up to the door, open the door, and I yell at my wife, hey, I forgot my keys, it's me, it's not a stranger, and I grab my keys, and I'm running out, and I see a neighbor of mine who I get along with extremely well. He starts shoveling his driveway for the first time. So 15 inches, so I'm like, I like doing this, so I go and grab my shovel, and I'm shoveling snow with him, and I'm having such a good time. We get along so well. We're talking about sports, we're talking about family, we're talking about future, we're talking about all this stuff, laughing and carrying on at about 8:30 in the morning. We're almost done, and I look up the street, and there is this individual shoveling their driveway for the first time. And now I'm left with a decision. And so I'll tell you, I'm being honest, I'm showing you my cards. I didn't want to. But what does the Bible say? Because this is what God was repeating in my brain. Be kind to those who persecute you, for it will reap burning coals on their heads. Do you know what that means? That is something that they did for shame. If you did something wrong, you had burning coals, and you held it on your head, and that would be the symbolism of feeling and symbolically shame. And what it was meant to do was to turn the individual from what they were doing back to God. That's the point. So when I'm doing something, when I'm being kind to somebody, it's not about me. It's still about the idea that Jesus can save this individual and that through their shame, God would be revealed to them and they would turn to him. So this is what's repeating in my brain. Shovel in my hand. I know this individual just watched me shovel this neighbor's driveway. And I have every reason in my mind, and I think worldly, why I don't have to do it. I shouldn't have to do it. And that's where I think a lot of us are. We know what the word says. We know what this says, this Bible. But are we doing what it says? So, it's full of commands, right? And that's where I was at. So as we look at this passage, don't worry, I'll finish the story later. Some of you guys are like, what happened? When we look at this passage, I want us to look at it through that lens. We know the Bible. We know what the Lord says. Are we doing it? Point number one, the life of the believer, the life of the believer. Within the context of this page, we notice something about Jesus. Jesus was a miracle worker. He did a lot of things, right? He was, everywhere he went, he had compassion and pity on people. That doesn't change in this story. What happens is they get done with a day of a lot happening. Jesus learns that his cousin John the Baptist had died. And so what happens is we see two miracles, phenomenal miracles, happens right next to each other. And the one previous to the walking on water is the feeding of the 5,000 in this book, in this letter that Matthew pens. And so what happens here is they actually go to what they're trying to find as a desolate place to rest. Does that sound like us when we have a hard day and we want that rest? I know I do. And I have four children, okay? So I really want rest, all right? But in this, they go to this desolate place. And if you can imagine, one of the things I like about these passages is I like seeing that it's that the disciples and seeing it from their vantage point, because I can relate to the disciple. A lot of us will talk about Jesus doing these things. We're like, yeah, he's Jesus. Like he's fully God. Come on. Well, what I love about the disciples is I can fully relate to these disciples. And you imagine being on the road, doing this, like all of this stuff, learning. You're drinking from a fire hydrant when you're walking with Jesus. And what happens is they go to this desolate place to rest, and they turn and look at Jesus, and people are following them. And I can just imagine them, like one of them, just Andrew going, ah, Jesus has that look in his eye. And then Jesus, it says he had compassion on the people. And I, being a disciple, would have been like, I'm ready to lay out my cot. And he starts healing their sick. But check this out in verse 14. He says this, or it says this, when he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion on them and healed their sick. Now, when it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, now, I believe all of us can relate to this. This is a desolate place. So that's excuse number one. And the day is now over. Send the crowds away into the villages and buy food for themselves. It's evening. It's dinner time. Let them go take care of themselves. What I love is what Jesus says here. They need not go away. You give them something to eat. There is a need. Fix it. Excuse number two. They said to him, we have only 5 loaves here and 2 fish. I love how loud those kids are. I do. I love it. So it's excuse number 2. They don't want to help. Can we understand that? They don't want to. And I think they just watched Jesus perform miracles, healing sick. They've been walking with Jesus and watching him do this. And then they get to a point where they go, you've hit your limit, right? So we can stop this now? We can finally close our eyes? And Jesus is like, we're not done yet. And we know the rest of that story where he feeds this 5,000 plus people with food left over. Isn't that amazing? And the disciples are helping. Now we don't know if they're helping begrudgingly, like, run out, you know, like all of these things. We don't know. But what we do know is this. Right after this, we see Jesus give them a command to get into a boat and go to the other side of the Sea of Galilee. Watch this happen, what Jesus does for them. Immediately, he made the disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. Have you noticed that? That in the midst of all of that, Jesus is taking care of his disciples. Like, he could have put that on them. Absolutely, he could have. But what a show of mercy and grace that he gives to his disciples right there. He sees their weariness. What I also love is Jesus knows what he's sending them into, because they're still going to learn. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But the boat by this time was a long way from the land, beaten by the waves, for the wind was against them. We know in the next verse that this is the fourth watch of the night. So this is between 3 and 6 a.m. And they are going across the Sea of Galilee, and a storm comes in. And if you know anything about that geographically, you will know that storms come in on the Sea of Galilee frequently. And they'll come in and they'll go, and they'll come in and they'll go. So it's like if you're going across, you could all of a sudden get hit by a storm that you didn't foresee. It's nighttime, though, so they can't necessarily see something coming in. And so they're on this boat, and they're getting hit by waves. They're getting hit by a headwind that is slowing their progress. What's interesting about this is our life. This is the life of a believer. We walk through storms constantly, and God allows us to move into them. The reason why this is so important is because when we are walking through these storms, God still has commands for us to follow. He still has written in his word things that we ought to do. I'm in that moment of with my neighbor, I am going through a storm with him. And I have a choice. This is the life of the believer. It keeps on saying, and in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, "It is a ghost." You know, I thought when I read that for the first time, I thought, why not? You know, life is so difficult. Let's throw in a ghost. Could you imagine them being that? They've never seen something walk on the water. And I could just imagine Thomas, the one that's like, "I got to see it to believe it," sitting there looking at this ghost going, "It's got to be a ghost. Like, we've gotten hit by a storm. Let's just throw a ghost into the mix." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Take heart. It is I. Do not be afraid." These words are what God said in Isaiah 41:10 to the Israelites when they were afraid. And these disciples knew that. But you think about when you're going through this storm and you have these things that you're supposed to do and you're listening to God. You're going across the Sea of Galilee and storms start happening. Isn't it a beautiful thing that you can turn to Jesus and he says those words, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." Point number two, the knowledge of the believer. The knowledge of the believer. So now they have an understanding. They heard Jesus say this. And what I love Peter. Do a study on just Peter. You'll fall in love with him too. He's that guy. He's all in. It's like, in a lot of ways, I'm the cannonball guy. I've told you that. I'm the cannonball guy into the cold pool. Like, I just want to get it over with, but I'm all in. I want to swim, all right? Peter's like that too. He is all in. And we see this because Peter hears this from Jesus, and he says this. Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And Jesus said, "Come." The knowledge of the believer is this. Peter knows that this is Jesus. He knows at this point that if it is Jesus, he will be able to come to him. Here's how we know this. He ultimately gets out of the boat. So Peter, knowing this, says this, "If it is you, tell me to come." And Jesus gives him the command. This is where I was at. I prayed to God, "God, give me a chance to serve." And then God looks at me and goes, "Serve. Here it is. I'm putting it on a silver platter for you. this is what I want to stress. Peter knows. He's seen the miracles. He's seen what Jesus can do. He's seen that through Jesus, this is possible. He knows it. But we would never know if he really believed it unless he got out of the boat. So I have sat with people and I've had great conversations about the Bible. And like your trigger words, right? Predestination, Calvinism, Arminian, eschatology, study of the end times, pre-mill, post-mill, pre-mid, post-trib, like all of these trigger words, right? They're good. They're great things to talk about. They're great things to process because it's biblical. These are good things to process. I once was talking to a teen and he walked up to me and said, he just said the one word, predestination. And I go, what about it? Did you know we were going to have this conversation? But I sat down and we talked. He said, what do you believe? And we talked and I thought it was great, great conversation. But ultimately, here's what I asked him. What are you doing with it? Cool, you know a lot about it. But I will tell you this. Knowledge without action doesn't matter. I believe that there are people that are saved because they believe in Jesus. Amen. That's it. I don't believe actions get you there. And I believe that there are many Christians that will live and die as an immature Christian believing in Jesus. And I'm glad they're in heaven. But even Paul says to the church of Corinth, he said, you guys are drinking milk and you ought to be eating meat. You're not doing anything. That's the point of James. James writes to the believer. What does he say? Be doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. Why does he say deceiving yourselves? It's because you're fooling yourself. He goes on to say that. If you want to flip over there to James, check this out, what he says here. In verse 23, for if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks intently at his natural face in a mirror. For he looks at himself, goes away, and at once forgets what he looks like. This is the individual who looks at himself in the mirror, walks away, and forgets the color of his eyes. What a metaphor. Because we would look at that, if someone did that right now, and they were like, Jason, right now, without looking, what's the color of your tie? And I couldn't tell you the color of my tie. You'd be like, is he blind? Is he colorblind? There would be something wrong. Like, there would be something. Because forgetting what you look like, it's kind of a big deal. It's so foolish. I love that he uses that illustration because anyone reading that would be like, that's ridiculous. That's what being just a hearer of the word is like. And so we read the Bible, right? Well, even maybe that's the case. We know the Bible says meditate on the word day and night. When was the last time you opened the word? I don't have time. And I'll be honest, I'm a pastor and there's some times where I forget. But day and night, that's a command. I know it, but am I doing it? Pray without ceasing. Do not forsake the gathering of believers. Do all things without complaining or grumbling. When we look at Romans 12, right, the marks of a true Christian, when we read that list, which ones are you discarding? That one's uncomfortable, so I don't have to do that one. We have home run commands, right? The ones that are really easy. For some of us, it is church. I'll show up to church, but don't ask me to share the gospel. That's hard. I'm not good at that. But man, can I read some books about stuff? This idea of knowledge, I will always raise up Bible literacy. If you are any of these teens have heard me say it a million times, know the Word of God. Because without knowing the Word of God, we can't know what to do, right? But this guy, Peter, knows. And some of you guys may have heard this analogy before. There was an illustration. This chair will hold you. If you sit in it, you will not fall through this chair. It is a well-built machine right here. Cool. Now, I have not done anything to this chair that you know of. Someone sit in it. You take a chair that no one's ever seen before, and honestly, some people may be like, he's pulling something. Like, is there something under there? Like, we know it'll hold us, but will we sit in it? That's the action. And we do this with so many things. I know I'm sticking a lot on this point number two. Bear with me. We know how to do a lot of things. In your job, you know how to do things, but no one would know if you know how to do it unless you did it. No one knows if you know Jesus unless you show them you know Jesus. Peter was seen as someone who knew Jesus in the book of Acts. People chased him, ran him out of town, not just because he knew it, but because he did it. In 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, it shows this. That the Word of God is God-breathed, inspired by God, and is profitable for multiple things. One is teaching. That's your knowledge. For correction and reproof. That's your maturing. That's refining what you believe. And then training in righteousness. That's the doing. And what does it say? That you may be complete for every good work. Not so that I can sit in a circle of people on my hands and talk about predestination. If you're all saved, where are you sharing the gospel? Because that's the command in Matthew 28. I know it may sound confrontational. I am so passionate about it. Because I see so many debates happening on Facebook. And so many people shouting out the things that they know. And shouting other people down. Right before James 1:22, it says this, be quick to listen and slow to speak. No one cares how smart you are. No one. If it is for you, it is not for God's glory. It doesn't matter. Souls need saving. How will they hear if no one says anything? That's doing the word. Point number three, the obedience of the believer. The obedience of the believer. I love this. So Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came to Jesus. Have you thought about that? Like, the other day, I put my kid in the water. And I thought about this. What if I sat him down and he didn't go in? I do. I think about this stuff all the time. I even thought about the other, a few summers ago, me and Matt Schneider, we were fishing with some friends of ours. And we always do this thing where we get into a paddle boat and we just yell paddle boat and we get in where I'm a kid at heart. And we have three people in this paddle boat and it is barely surviving. And Matt's standing on the bank and I'm going, get in the boat. Like, come on, Matt. And he's like, we're going to go under. I was like, who cares? Let's do it. And so Matt gets in the boat. We start paddling. We're giving it our all, and we start sinking, and we're like, get to the shore, like, we're just, it would be crazy if we didn't sink. I relate to Peter in this moment, because can you imagine wind, the wind, the waves, and Peter gets out, and doesn't sink. As hard as this is, and he starts walking to Jesus. Yeah, Jesus can do it because he's God. Don't dismiss that. We see that Jesus is fully God. This is one of those moments. That's your put on your Christology hat. We see two things in the story. One, Jesus was tired, which means he's fully man, and he walked on water, which means he's fully God. But now Peter, through not Peter's doing, but through Jesus, he was able to walk on that water. And Peter knew that. So he walks to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried out, Lord, save me. That's a good thing for us to remember. When we are doing things for the Lord, we have committed. We've said, we're not just going to know it, we're going to do it. Do you know that it's not going to always go the way you planned? There's going to be things that happen. That's why I say in one of the biggest attributes in ministry you need to learn is adaptability. Because things are coming from all sides and places, personalities, things you can't control. And Peter gets out of the boat, and he's walking, and he sees the life, right? He sees what's happening. He sees the distractions. And as he's walking to Jesus, he starts sinking. This is us. We're going to fail a lot when we choose to do what the Word of God says. We're going to fail a lot. But that's why we need to remember this three-word prayer. Lord, save me. Because in the midst of doing it, we could become prideful, thinking we can save ourselves. We could pull ourselves out of this mess. And instead, the very reason why you're walking on water is the only reason that will save you. And so life is happening and you're sinking. And Peter goes, Lord, save me. And what I love is Jesus wasn't like, that second, like, baptize and hold him under the water another second. You know what I'm talking about? Like, Jesus didn't play that. He wasn't messing around. He was teaching Peter something. He pulls him out of the water. Jesus immediately, he acts, reached out his hand and took hold of him, saying to him, oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt? I want us to realize something. There were other disciples in the boat. And Peter's the only one that learned something in that moment. Peter learned that he needs to rely on Jesus in those times. He was the only one that received criticism from Jesus at that moment. No one else did. That should teach us something. That in the midst of doing something, Jesus is refining you. Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt? You're right, Jesus. You're right. I need to rely on you more. We learn this. right? When we're failing, when we've done something wrong, when we're messing up in the midst of doing something for the Lord, you need me more. You need me more. You need me more. I love backpacking. And there's a lot that I'm reading about it, right? What to pack, what not to pack, that sort of stuff. But here's what everybody says. Get out there and do it. Because then you know what to pack, what not to pack, with all of this stuff. I won't know it unless I do it, right? And I'll learn as I do it. What I need, what I don't need. And Jesus is going, when you do it, you're going to learn that you need me a lot more. And you're going to need everything else a lot less. Peter is the one that learns this. Point number four. The influence of the believer. I want you to watch what happens. Because Peter was willing to get out of the boat, I think that there was a lot of influence here. I think there's a lot of things that happen at this moment. And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. And those in the boat worshiped him, Jesus, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." They watched Jesus walk on water. Then they watched their friend walk on water. Then they got into the boat and the wind ceased. All because of Jesus. I want us to know that because your obedience is to the glory of God, not to yourself. But people are watching. And as they're watching, they're going to see either you or they're going to see Jesus. And so when we see this, this is my prayer as I live my life. When I'm choosing to not just know the word, but to do the word, that people would see Jesus. That like Peter, they would say, or what the leader said to Peter, he must have been with Jesus. And I'm fine if they call me unlearned. The end of the story goes like this. So I'm standing there with my shovel, and what's going through my head is I got to get to the church. I got things I got to do. You know, I worked from home but for the past 2 days, but that can only go so much because the kids didn't have school, and you're making phone calls in another room, but then you're also holding your 8-month-old baby and making a phone call. And so I got things, got to prep for Sunday, and I got all this in my head, and I'm like, man, I don't have time. But the thing that kept coming into my mind is, what does the Bible say? What's the command here? So I grabbed the shovel, and I walk down the road, and I get to this individual's house, and I look at him, and I say, "Do you need help shoveling your driveway?" And his words were, "As long as no one prays for me." So I walked away. No, I didn't. I didn't. I said, okay. And I shoveled his driveway with him. And we had the best conversation. No, I did not get to share the gospel with him. Yes, I was praying in my head the whole time. He knows I'm a pastor. I don't need to tell him that I go to church. I don't need to tell him anything. I just need to serve him. That's what the Bible calls me to do. And so I shoveled in. Here's what I learned. People are hurting. Through that action, I learned that his family is going through a lot of things. The pipe bursting on their house, there's different things happening, that water damage and all of this stuff. And I just am listening, and I'm like, I'm so sorry. I did not say, can I pray with you? He doesn't want that right now. There may come a day where he does, but it's not now. But when he needs help, I will be there, because that's what the Bible says to do. Now, I'm not tooting my own horn. I will admit to you, I miss out a lot. I'm not batting 1,000 when it comes to this thing. But I want to. And I want you to as well. Not because of what I want, but because of what God wants. So what is the call? Be doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving yourself. Don't be like the man that walks away after intently looking at himself and forgetting what he looks like. Know the word and do the word. They go hand in hand. They don't go, you can't, it's not just doing without knowing, because we got to know who we know in order to be fueled into what we're doing. He's the sustenance. But we need to know what we're doing before we do it. So that's my challenge. That's God's challenge for us. There are opportunities. Pastor Mark just did a series a month or two ago on spiritual gifts. And we all took tests to do them. Are you using them? God gave you interests. He gave you hobbies. He gave you natural gifts. He gave you all of these things. Not for you. He did it because Colossians 1:16 says that we were made for him. It's for him. All of it. The glory. All of it is to him. So are you doing the word? Or are you just hanging out? There's a Howard Hendricks, Dr. Howard Hendricks wrote a book, and he said this line. Trying to make sure I get it right. He said, some of us need to start doing what the Lord said, or stop calling him Lord. And when I read that, that was a gut punch. That's a gut check right there. Start doing what he says, or stop calling him Lord. Because that he wants it all. He said to the rich young ruler, right? Sell all you have. Come be my disciple. And he walked away sad, because he couldn't give it all away. He wasn't willing to follow the Lord. Be doers of the word, not hearers only. Amen? Let's pray. God, thank you for your word. Thank you for what you bring to the table, because it's everything. And we're just coming to sit and learn, and then you're charging us to go out of the house and be ambassadors for you. Father, I pray that it would be like you empowering Peter to walk on water, that you would be empowering us to go out and share the gospel and do things to your glory every day. We need your help. Give us the courage to do it. Give us the opportunities to do it. And in everything, when the storm of life hits, that we would look to see what your word says and live it out. And we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.